Welcome to Living Word Ministries with our director and Bible teacher, Debbie Blank. Debbie's passion is for you to understand and apply God's truths to your life. Now let's listen and enjoy teaching from the Word of God with Debbie Blank.
Father, of all the gifts in this world that we could receive, there is no gift like the salvation of Jesus Christ that you give us. You choose us before the foundation of the world that we might come into your kingdom and be part of your family. There is no greater gift than that. That's something that I pray for my family, for my descendants, for everyone I know, because money is fleeting. Life and health will be gone, but you will be forever. You have been and you will be. And our lives with you will be forever. Or we'll spend forever away from you. And I don't want that for anybody. Thank you, Father, for making the opportunity for salvation, for giving it to us through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for your word that outlines exactly what salvation is. Even though we can't understand some certain things, you are clear as to what it takes and what you would have us do. So as we study salvation today, Father, would you speak to our hearts? Would you open our hearts and let us see what you want us to know and how you want us to apply it to our lives? Each one of us is in a different place, and each one of us needs to hear from you differently. So speak to us, we pray. In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, amen. As we're getting into the discussion of salvation, we have to go back. And going back, we go all the way back to the purpose of this book, which we see in chapter 5, verse 12 of 1 Peter. What does that say? What is the purpose of this book? Raise your hand, please, if you want to share the answer. Yes. That glorious inheritance that we have. And we are to stand firm in that glorious inheritance. Stand firm in the true grace of God. That's what we're exhorted to do in this book, is to stand firm. We'll talk later about what it means to be able to stand firm. We're right now just walking through what this true grace is, because it's so important to understand. And the true grace we determined through the context is salvation. Now, we also discussed that there's another grace, and that's the grace that helps us in time of need. Both of them are charis. They both have the same Hebrew Greek name, but they both mean something different. And one is the day-by-day grace to make it through everyday life. Then there's the true grace that draws us to God in the form of salvation. So the purpose of this book is to stand firm in our salvation, in the true grace. Last week, we spent a lot of time on the first two verses, the last couple weeks, and the first two verses in the doctrine of salvation. It's difficult to understand. We talked a lot about how there's two roads leading in the same direction. One is the sovereignty of God, and one is the responsibility of man. Right up here, second row, waiting for you. The responsibility of man. They both are pointed in the same direction towards salvation. That is, the doctrine of salvation is that God chose us. We are the elect. We have been, according to verse 2, we were chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit. Do you notice that we're chosen by God the Father? The sanctifying work of the Spirit draws us to God. And the King James says, unto obedience of Christ and the sprinkling of his blood, which means that salvation comes from Jesus Christ, his death for our sins. And we need to be obedient to that. That's where our responsibility comes in salvation, is being obedient to the accepting that free gift of salvation. But God does all the rest, and there's a lot of rest for him to do. So this week, we're going to start in verses 3 through 5, and we're going to discuss the timing of salvation. This chart was in your homework. So if you did your homework, you have this chart. I just put it up here so we can review it to understand what we're seeing here and what it's saying to us. So let's begin today in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. After we've seen the Trinity in the first couple of verses, it starts out in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, according to his great mercy," what's mercy? Undeserved favor, compassion. God's compassion is undeserved favor that he gives to you and I. And it's because of this undeserved favor, this compassion, that he has caused us to be what?
Born again.
You know, that's a term that a lot of people said was a negative term for a long time because it meant we were these radicals. But this is a term from the Word of God. As a matter of fact, it's a term directly out of John 3, Jesus' own words. He says, you must be born again. What does it mean to be born again? After all, John 3, Nicodemus said, how can you be going back into your mother's womb? Okay, she says you identify yourself with the doctrine of Jesus Christ, the salvation, and the resurrection. Born again simply means to beget again. But you can't beget again physically, so it must be talking about something else. And here it is, a spiritual rebirth. We didn't make a decision to be born the first time. It just happened, however God allowed it to happen. But we do make a decision as to whether we are going to be born again. That is our decision. Not everybody chooses the free gift of salvation. Not everyone chooses to be born again. But those of us who do have the opportunity to identify with Jesus Christ, to be spiritually born again. Those of you who've had that radical change, I know that there are many people who accept Christ as a child, and there's no real radical difference. I mean, my kids accepted Christ as the Lord and Savior young, and their lives have just kind of been, you know, pretty normal. I was 24 when I accepted the Lord. So I saw a real difference between what I was like before and what I'm like now. Radical change? No. I've heard some amazing stories of somebody with a radical change, with people with radical changes. And I don't know if there's anybody that wants to share that or not right now, but it's a radical, radical change, where you chose to live in the world and then you chose to follow Jesus Christ. Anybody want to share? Well, I have a friend who just passed away. I mentioned him last spring, because he was a biker. And he's like 6'4", and big and rough and tough, and he had tattoos all over his hands. And I mean, this guy was a biker. When I saw a picture of him from when he was in jail, his beard was like down to here and he was scraggly and he just looked really like a biker and like the old-fashioned biker you would assume. And this guy got saved in prison. And I mean, he got radically saved. He's the one that when he found out, went in for shoulder surgery for just a normal physical last spring and found out that he had stage 4 cancer and has since died. He passed away 2 weeks ago. His response was, I get to go be with Jesus. And he didn't stop working his ministry. His name stayed on all the letters of his ministry until about the last 3 weeks. And then somebody else's name was on there. Because this guy was radically saved. So some of us have this, you know, well, I just pretty much always been a Christian. And some of us have this radical difference. But the point is, there has to be a difference. There has to be a time. Just as there was a time when I got married, I was Debbie maiden name, and then I was Debbie blank. I made a decision to get married. And I became a new name, new relationship. That's the same way in our born again experience. It's a decision that we make in faith to follow Jesus Christ. So it's a past decision. When we're born again, well, at least for me, it's a past decision. If you're not born again yet, it's not a past decision for you yet. But for those of us who've done it, it happened in the past. I have been saved, or I was saved in the past. The question is, what are we saved from? We're saved from sin, really. Now, we're not saved. That doesn't mean we're holy and we're 100% sinless once we're saved, does it? No, it doesn't. Instead, it means we're saved from the penalty of sin from through Christ's death, and then, as the chart says, from the dominion of sin by my death. So we looked at a couple verses for the penalty of sin. Romans 3 is, well, I always say a book is my favorite book or a passage is my favorite passage, but there's too many favorites. But Romans 3 is one of the greatest places in Scripture that really explains our salvation. So let's go there for a minute and take a look at this. Verses 21 to 24, except I'm going to take you probably through 26. It says, but now, apart from the law, by the way, the previous verses have said that we're sinners. In verse 10, there is none righteous, not even one. There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God. None, zero, zip. Got it? Then he says, verse 21, but now, but, contrast, now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. So the Old Testament, the law and the prophets manifested the righteousness of God. Verse 22, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Everywhere you look in Scripture, it's faith. It is faith that saves us. As I've been studying and for an upcoming trip, I just can't even believe the number of times faith is in these passages when Paul talks about them. But the reason it is because that's our responsibility. We have one responsibility, and that's faith. Faith and belief scripturally are almost always the same word, pistis. So when you see faith, the noun, pistis, or the verb pisteo, and you see believe or belief, they're almost always the same word because they mean the same thing. The only way to be born again is to have faith in Jesus Christ. It is through that faith that we then are saved. It's through Jesus Christ and what he's done, but we must have faith in who he is. It says, verse 22 again, even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all those who believe. So you have faith and you believe. For there's no distinction. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All have sinned. See, if we're going to be born again, we have to recognize that we have the penalty of sin in our lives. And it can only be dealt with through Jesus Christ, which it says in verse 24. For we are justified as a free gift by his grace. Justified is just as if I'd never sinned. He covers our sin with his blood. It's a free gift through his grace, through the redemption which is in Christ Jesus. He not only covers our sin, but then he redeems us. He pays the price for our sin. So you and I don't have to stand before the judge anymore with the penalty of sin because Jesus has paid the price. He's gone before the judge, and he has paid that penalty for you and I. So you and I are free if we will believe. We're free to be born again. Verse 25, whom God, talking about Jesus Christ, God displayed him publicly as a propitiation in his blood through faith. Do you see? All these words are so important. It's through his blood. That's his death. But it says here propitiation. What is propitiation? Okay. So the way she remembers propitiation is the example of Jesus is in a pit and God pours all of his wrath out on him and then it's covered. It's satisfied. All of God's wrath for sin is satisfied on Jesus Christ. That's what propitiation is. It's satisfying the penalty of sin on mankind. And only the perfect sacrifices once for all, the just for the unjust, could do that. And that perfect sacrifice is Jesus. So propitiation of Jesus means God's wrath over sin was satisfied through him, in his blood, through faith. This was the demonstration of his righteousness, because in the forbearance of God, he passed over sins previously committed. That's the idea of this pit. God pours his wrath on Jesus through his blood and death on the cross, and then God just passes right over the pit from now on for anybody who believes. You like that? Amen, amen. Because in the forbearance of God, he passed over the sins previously committed for the demonstration, I say, of his righteousness. It's all because of God's righteousness that he does this. At the present time, his righteousness at the present time, that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus Christ. Faith and believe are mentioned several times in there because Jesus is the one who pays the penalty by his death. But we can only appropriate that penalty. We can only appropriate that satisfaction, that propitiation that Christ has done for us if we will believe. We can only do it that way. No other way. We can't do it by books of the law. We can't do it by following the book of the law. We can't do it by good works. We can't do it by rituals, baptism, confirmation, and any of those things. They don't save us. And if you question that, read Romans 4, because it is laid out perfectly in Romans 4. None of those things save us. Only faith in Jesus Christ saves us. That's what it means to be born again. I receive Jesus. I am born again. I am saved from sin's penalty when I receive Jesus. That's called justification, just as if I'd never sinned. It happened for me and for most of you in the past. But just because it happened in the past, is it over? All right, I'm saved now. I can do whatever I want because I got that key to heaven. Is that what we can do? No. I mean, the Bible is full of it. I mean, I just was reading Ephesians. And Ephesians is all about who I am in Christ and then how I'm supposed to live in Christ. Paul, he talks about sin, salvation, and then he talks about sanctification right here in Romans, how we're supposed to live out our salvation. It's not just a one-time thing. So people who think that they can do whatever they want, one must question if the Holy Spirit is in their hearts. Now, it's not our position to question people, but it is our position to question ourselves. If I'm living like the world, then I need to ask myself, am I filled with the Spirit? Am I born again? Do I really have a relationship with Jesus Christ? Now, sin reigns in our bodies. It says here that we are all sinners. That doesn't stop when we're born again. So we're still sin. I've been studying for a month. Sunday we leave on a Paul's European journeys. I've been studying for a month, but I've really been studying the last couple weeks, and it's been awesome. Just digging into the Word of God. And last night on the way home from dinner, I stopped and ran an errand when Bob went somewhere. And I got so irritated at this person that I was dealing with that the 15 minutes it took me to get home, I was just irritated. And I got home and I was irritated. And I thought, I've been having such a ball in the Word of God where God tells me who he is and how he wants me to live. And then I get out from my little cubbyhole of study and I get into the world and I go, "Rrr!" And then I'm reminded that I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. I make mistakes. We just need to confess those sins when we make them. Satan would love to have taken me and said, "Okay, now I gotcha. And I'm just going to keep you irritated." But I know God enough to know that he forgives me, and all I have to do is ask forgiveness.
Thank you for being transparent.
You're welcome.
We're all there.
We all are there. I am transparent. I have no secret. You can ask me anything. Born again. We are born again. The question that you need to ask today is, have you been born again? Have you been born again? Let's go back to John 3, because that is such an important passage. It's a different Greek word that's used here in born again, but I think it's important for us to catch the picture of it. When Nicodemus is talking to Jesus, and Jesus says in verse 3 of John 3, "Truly I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven." And Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he's old? He cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born, can he?" And Jesus answered and said, Truly I say to you, unless one is born of the water and spirit, water being born physically with the sack of water, and the spirit which is born spiritually, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Verse 6 of John 3, that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from and where it is going. So is everyone who is born of the Spirit. So he talks there about the importance of being born physically, of the sack of water that brings you forward into this world, and then spiritually by the Spirit. Are you born again? That's what salvation is being born again. A one-time past decision that you made that is all based on Jesus Christ and his finished work at the cross, where he paid the penalty for sin and you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Not mentally, or should I say not just mentally, but remember from John 3, from the Spirit. You do it in your heart. You surrender to Jesus Christ. Faith is actually, or belief, how the word pistis in the Greek is actually three-prong. It's a three-prong stool. It means first, conviction of who Jesus Christ is. So that's a head knowledge. Nothing wrong with head knowledge, knowing who he is. The second part, however, is we stop sometimes at that head knowledge. But the second, backtrack. You can't sit on a stool with one leg. You wobble all over the place. And you can't be saved with just head knowledge. Instead, you must surrender to who Jesus Christ is. That is, he's God, he's our Savior, he covered us with his blood, he died on the cross, he rose again from the dead, he covered our sins, he paid the penalty for us. That's the second prong. But it doesn't even stop there. According to Ephesians 2:10 that we read last week, once we're saved, we are created in God for good works, which God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. So we have a past, a present, and a future in our salvation. We have a time where we came to know Jesus Christ. We have a time when we lived with Jesus Christ. And then we're going to have a time when we be with Jesus Christ for all eternity. We're created in him for good works. That's the present, what God prepared beforehand, that we should walk in them. Justification. Have you been born again? That's the most important question you can ever ask yourself. And if you aren't sure, talk to me, talk to some of the other gals in the group, talk to God, because he's the one that'll show you, and he's the one that needs to. I can't tell you if you're born again. Only God can tell you. So you talk to him. But if you're not sure, come to one of us, because we'd love to talk to you. Now, going back to 1 Peter 3, it says, by God's great mercy, he's caused us to be born again to a what? Living hope. What is a living hope? What is hope?
Anticipation of what's ahead.
Okay, anticipation of what's ahead. When we're talking about hope in God, we're talking about confident anticipation or confident expectation of everything that God gives us. Confident expectation is what hope is. Now, this is talking about a living hope. So what does that conjure in your mind? Jesus
is our living hope. You know, he's what we are looking forward to. You know.
Yeah, he is. He is our hope. Everything about him is our hope. In this context, when it's talking about a living hope, it says it's through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So there's a little separation here, a living hope through Jesus Christ. See, living hope is present tense. I see that as present tense salvation. The living hope, the present tense in Greek, is always ongoing. So we are born again to an ongoing, consistent hope. It means it never ends. And it comes through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So if our hope never ends, then we're going to see that our salvation never ends. And it's ongoing. A good question, is the living hope the motivation for obedience? That's a very good question. What do you think? Okay, uh-huh. Good answer. Anybody want to put some meat on that? Amen. She quoted Romans 8, the confident hope that Jesus is always with me. I'm actually going to save the rest of that discussion until we get over to verse 8, because we'll talk a little bit more about that idea over in verse 8. So let's continue on. A living hope, and we're going to hold that thought about present salvation, because this living hope is through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And then it says in verse 4, what do we have? What does this living hope give us? What does this born-again relationship with Jesus Christ give us? An inheritance. Now that's pretty cool. If you lived in this earth and you needed money, wouldn't it be great to be a relative of Bill Gates or Warren Buffett? Because you would inherit a boatload of money. If that's important to you, you can't think of anything better than that. But if something spiritual is important to you, if you got your mind off of this world and on to the heavenlies, what would be important? To have God's inheritance, to be a child of God. Getting back to Romans 8, it talks about us being heirs, calling God Abba, Father. He is our God. It says here, we obtain an inheritance. That means it's a secure possession. In this case, we're not talking about money. We're talking about the security of a relationship with God. How long?
Forever.
It will never end. An inheritance which is imperishable, that means it's unravaged by any invading army. I love the definition from that. Nobody can take it away. It's imperishable. Nobody can destroy it or take it away. And it's undefiled. What does undefiled mean? Pure. Okay. Or undefiled would mean it's pure because it's not defiled. It's not polluted by anything. And it also will what? Not fade away. There's no decay. There's no change. And finally, in verse 4, what does it say? Reserved in heaven for you. Now, that's a perfect passive participle in the Greek. What it means is brought about by a finished action. And the action, it doesn't say who the action is from, but when our salvation is reserved in heaven for you, the action is by Jesus Christ, by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, according to this context here. So we have four things, it says here, an inheritance. When we're born again, we are God's children. I mean, I can't fathom anything better than that. Being children of the King of the universe. We are imperishable, and that means we won't fade away. We're holy, we're undefiled. Again, unchanging, no decay. And then finally, I guess five things, it's reserved in heaven. It's already happened. It's already waiting for us. If you have a reservation at a hotel or a restaurant, they're waiting for you when you come. Oh, hi, Mrs. Blank, we have your room right here. And, you know, it feels good when you walk in and they're waiting for you. Heaven, God has reserved a spot for you if you're born again. And he's waiting for you. Now, I take very lightly stories of people who die and go to heaven. You know, they're stories. They're people's experiences. I'm always careful with those because unless they match up 100% with Scripture, I don't know if they're right or wrong. They're their experiences. When I think of so many of them say that right when they're dying or right when they die, Jesus meets them right there in heaven, or an angel meets them and takes them to Jesus, I think, wow. I mean, he's the ultimate maitre d'. He is there waiting for us with outstretched arms. I believe that's true, whether or not somebody's experience says it is. I believe he's waiting with outstretched arms to welcome you into his kingdom. And there you will be forever. You will not fade away if you're born again. That's our future hope. I shall be saved in the future. I shall have my eternal inheritance from God. Why? Through the present. It's up through the redemption of Jesus Christ. That's why I can get there. And I get a new body. 1 Corinthians 15 talks all about our imperishable bodies. and what it's going to be like to be with God will never fade away. That's glorification. That's God finally glorifying us. Now, one of the things that you said there in part of your question, so I'm going to ask you, is what does the glorification, what does this future salvation do for you today? Hope. It gives us hope. No matter how bad life is on this earth, no matter how good it is. Unfortunately, if it's good, we want to stay here. If it's bad, we want to leave. I can't tell you the number of people that say to me, I wish the rapture would come now. Because we don't want to go through the things that are bad, that are happening. But it's our hope. It's what we as Christians should look forward to more than anything. I'm going to go back to my friend Tom, who just passed away. He was not concerned about dying. He wasn't even concerned about leaving his wife and his kids. They're all grown, especially his wife. But he wasn't concerned about leaving them. He wasn't concerned about leaving the ministry. He was excited to be with Jesus. Now, this guy was 60, right around 60 years old. I mean, in the scheme of things, he was a young man. But instead of saying, oh, I got to finish my work here on earth, or I need to be with my family more, I need to be with my kids more, his whole goal was his future salvation, which is to be with Jesus. He knew if God wanted to take him, his work here was finished. But his eyes were on Jesus. Our eyes are to be on Jesus all the time. Our eyes are to be on the future. How do the people who are having their heads cut off by ISIS, the Christians who are having their heads cut off, how do they do that? I believe it's a hope of where they're going when they die. How do you live through some of the circumstances of life? It's the hope of Jesus that's in you and the hope that you have of being with him. You're here for a reason. As long as there's a breath in your body, you have a reason for being here. Now, you might not know what it is, but God does, and he wants to use you. But a hope is in the future. Our salvation from the past guarantees us a future. That's pretty neat. Prince Charles, when he was born physically in England, was guaranteed a future. He was going to be King of England. Maybe. But that ultimately was the original thought. When you and I are born again, we're guaranteed reigning with our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, is that not enough to excite you? I mean, no matter what happens in everyday life, no matter the little irritants of last night or the big frustrations of death or health or finances or interpersonal problems, no matter what they are, we have our hope in God. That's where our hope needs to be focused. She said the hope of God reminds her to rest and to know that he is enough. Talking about rest, if you read Hebrews chapters 5 and 6, it talks about resting in Jesus, knowing that he's enough for everything that happens. I'm going on this Paul's missionary trip. I'm thinking about Paul, and it has always bothered me that if Paul just hadn't appealed to Caesar, he would have still been able to continue his ministry work because they would have found him innocent. Why didn't you just wait? But then as I've studied and I've read more, I realize that he was just following God's direction for his life because God said, I want you to go to Rome. And he wasn't manipulating it that I'm going to get to Rome this way. I believe he was following God every step of the way. And when he appealed to Caesar and then ended up in Rome the first time, it was God's will for him. And it didn't matter that he was still a relatively young man. It mattered that he was doing God's will. So whether God chooses to take us home at 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 or 100, we're still doing God's will while we're here. We're still working out the salvation. So let's get to that working out. Let's get to that present part of our salvation, our sanctification, which you're going to talk about in class next week, the sanctification. But we want to mention it here because it's mentioned in these verses. Verse 5, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 5. Let me go back to verse 4. We're obtaining an inheritance. It's reserved in heaven for you, verse 5, who are, protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last times. It says, who are protected? What does protected mean?
Nobody can take that away from you.
Okay, nobody can take it away from you.
Safe.
Safe. Nobody can take it away from you. I'll see if I can read my notes here because I love the definition. God stands sentinel over us. He's like a guard that never changes. So when we're protected, it's like God standing over and around us. Nothing can ever destroy us. We're safe in God's arms as his heirs of his kingdom. We are protected, there is present tense, by the way. We are consistently, ongoing, forever and ever protected. That's present tense. We are protected. How are we protected? By the power of God. The dunamis, the dynamite, the power. That's the power that raised Jesus from the dead. That's how we're protected. She talked, and we're going to talk a little more about that in a few minutes, but she talked about how every trial is filtered through the hands of God. And God doesn't give us anything more than we can handle. That's not exactly what 1 Corinthians 10:13 says, but it's pretty close. No temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation, will provide the way of escape so you may be able to endure it. 1 Corinthians 10:13. That's kind of, we paraphrase that to say God won't give us anything that we can't handle. But it comes, I really think, from 1 Corinthians 10:13. She gives a great point here that in Romans 8 and again in Hebrews 7, it tells us that Jesus lives to make intercession for us. That means that he's up there praying for you and I who are born again through his blood. He is praying for us so that we will have the faith to withstand anything that this world has to offer. He is praying that we won't fail, that we won't turn away, that we won't sin. He's praying for us through all of our trials. And she, I mean, just think about that. I mean, sometimes when we ask people, I had a very saintly friend who has since passed away, but if ever I had a problem, I always called her because she had a direct connection to God, you know? We always think that certain people have that direct connection to God. Well, the fact is we all have that direct connection. But what better connection is there than Jesus Christ, who's up there praying for you and I right now, if we have a relationship with him, if we're born again? Okay, does somebody else have your hand raised? Okay, let's continue on. Verse 5. Who are protected, continuous ongoing, by the power of God, the power that raised Jesus from the dead, that dunamis, through faith, for a what? Salvation ready to be revealed in the last day. Now, this is the first time we see salvation. We've been talking a lot about it, but this is the first time we see it. What is it and what does it mean? Okay, the glorification ready to be revealed in the last days. Specifically, salvation means?
Saved.
Saved by grace.
Strong says rescue or safety.
Rescue or safety, deliverance. Salvation is deliverance. Rescue or safety. We are saved from our sins. We are rescued from our sins. That is salvation. Salvation is the noun. You and I are saved from our sins. That's a verb. That's an action that Jesus does. But the noun is salvation. You and I are delivered. We are saved through the blood of Jesus Christ. Salvation. And it says this salvation is ready to be revealed in the last time. As you said, that's glorification. Another future aspect. So we have here, we've read past, present, and future salvation. It's all together. Now, again, next week is sanctification, the discussion of how we live out our salvation day by day. That's going to be the discussion next week, so we're not going to focus a lot on this. But it's important. It's important that we don't give up, that we don't just say, I'm saved, I'm going to heaven, I can skip this part. Because here we find out that salvation really is, the middle part's the most important part. And we're going to find out that in just a minute. Any comments before we move on? Yeah, she's saying, she's correlating the Trinity, the idea of the Trinity, with the idea of past, present, future here. It's all together. It all works together. Gee, isn't that interesting? If you read Genesis through Revelation, guess what? It all fits together. There may be some things we don't understand completely, but it all fits. It's all written by the same person. Now, he used 40 different authors, human authors, but it's all written by the same God. Okay, I haven't heard that before, but I like that. So I'm going to write above here, spirit, soul, and body, because that really does make a difference. That really does make a lot of sense. Our spirit, as we read from John 3, is born again. And then our soul is our mind, will, and emotions, our living out our salvation day by day. And our bodies, well, 1 Corinthians 15, that's where we're going to be resurrected with new bodies, because if we're not, we couldn't be in heaven. So thank you for sharing that. She said that was from Robert Morris, and I like that. I think that makes perfect sense and a good way to remember it. That's why I love discussion. We all learn from each other. Well, now we have this salvation. I'm assuming after our discussion over the last few weeks that you understand salvation. You understand who's involved. First of all, who did it? And it was God. It was all God. God painted the entire picture. There's a little dot in this picture that is my imprint of my faith. But God is the one through the Trinity who made it all possible and who died for our sins and who rose from the dead. So that's our salvation. And now this is what I have to do. I have to be born again. I have to make a decision of faith. I need to live it out. And then I get to look forward to the glorification here. But we start getting into our responsibility here of salvation after we learn up here about what God has done for us. But now that we're saved, we've got a life to live. And it's going to be a bed of roses. I tell the story many, many, many times that when I got saved, shortly thereafter, I voted for a born-again believer as president of the United States because I was born again and he was born again. Therefore, we must be 100% like-minded. Well, I found out we weren't. That was not the case. When my husband got saved, I thought, oh, praise God, now we're going to be in 100% unison with each other, everything spiritually. That's good. Yeah, right. That doesn't happen. Why? If we're born again with the same spirit and we have the same inheritance, how come we aren't all the same? Because God made us all unique. He made us all unique. We have different personalities. We have different backgrounds. We have different baggage. We have different desires. Everything about us is different. God gifts us differently. On a spiritual gifts chart, mercy is way down here with me, way down low. So I tend, mercy people who come with all the compassion and the caring and stuff, I say, well, let's just get to the details. Because I'm a teacher and administrator. You know, that's not bad, and his mercy's not bad. We just are different in how God has made us and gifted us. So we think differently. We're also at different levels of our maturity. Some of us may be brand new believers, and some of us may have been around for decades. So we all are at a different place. We can't expect everything to be the same. But one thing we do know once we get saved is that in verse 6, the first couple verses tell us what we should be doing. And what does it say? In this you greatly rejoice. Do you greatly rejoice in your salvation? Oh, I hope you do. I mean, when I was first saved, I knew I had made a decision. I can't tell you that I was overjoyed with it because I didn't fully understand it. I knew what I had done. I knew I made a conscious decision to follow Jesus, but I didn't understand what it all meant. So I can't say I jumped for joy, but the idea here is of greatly rejoicing is being overjoyed in hilarity practically because of our salvation. That's what it's talking about here. That's what God wants us to have. Now, I've grown into that. But at first, I just didn't know. I was ignorant about a lot of things. I was ignorant about pretty much everything until God's Spirit taught me. But God wants us to rejoice. And now that I understand it, who can't rejoice at this? At what God has done for us and what he has given us and what our hope is in the future. This is what he greatly wants us to greatly rejoice on. Now, there are people, and I think Kay is one of them, who says that this greatly rejoicing has to do with the trials. I don't read it this way because it says, in this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while. So you're rejoicing in this that he just talked about rather than what we're getting into, which are the trials. Because who rejoices in trials? You do? All right. You have learned. The first time you had trials, did you rejoice in them? Oh, no. It's a process, though. It's a learning process. But he says, in this you greatly rejoice. I believe he's talking about our salvation. Everything that we have in Christ, we greatly rejoice. And we rejoice even though, now for a little while, if necessary, you've been distressed by various trials. So once we become a believer, what's going to happen to us? Yeah, we're going to be distressed by various trials. The proof of our salvation is going to come into play. You and I are going to be distressed. I want to put that up here too. We are distressed by trials. Now, what do these trials look like? That's exactly right. They are different for everyone because everyone brings different baggage into our salvation. Now, I am so glad the day I got saved that God didn't say, okay, Debbie, you need to now be perfect. So you got to work on all those sins in your life, smoking and drinking and cussing and yada, yada. If he had done that to me, I would have crashed. But little by little, he starts working on the things in my life and he knows what they are. And he needs to bring in the trials in my life to take away my dross, to take away my issues in my life. And my issues are different from your issues. So each one of our trials is going to be different. She says, she quotes a verse where Jesus says, he came to give us life and came to give us abundantly. So we have our highs and we have our lows. I mean, that's life. But with Christ, they're higher highs and then they can be lower lows because we've been up so high. Why do we think we should have a rose garden? Well, part of it is Disney tells us that we're going to live happily ever after. If we grow up in a good home, we just think everything's going to be okay. But wait a minute. Do you know what 1 Peter 2, I'm going to take you ahead a little bit. 1 Peter chapter 2 says, let me read it to you because you'll see it here soon. It says, verse 21, you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example for you to follow. Jesus suffered. He's an example for us. What does that mean for us? We're going to suffer. You look at the Gospels, and Jesus said, what I'm experiencing, basically you're experiencing, and I'm paraphrasing here. And they killed Jesus, so they're not going to accept our testimony of Jesus or our life for Jesus either. We can expect trials because Jesus expected trials. We are not of the world, folks. We may live in the world, but we're not to be of the world. And that means the world's not going to like us. That means you and I are going to go through various trials. We're going to go from trials from without, from the world who wants to hurt us, ISIS wanting to kill Christians, our country taking away our Christian rights little by little. What's happening in North Carolina makes me sick right now. That you have a state that's being forced by money, by the NFL and now by the NCAA, that they are going to have to change their policies about bathrooms in order to have any kind of athletic events in their state. I mean, we're being forced from without in our Christianity and trials from without. But we also have trials from within. In the spirit of transparency. Probably my two biggest trials in my Christian walk have been money and my husband. because Bob and I are completely different, and he didn't come to know the Lord for a long time, and then when he did, he didn't walk with the Lord. So, you know, those were trials and struggles. And money was a trial because we came from a comfortable background, and then we went down. And then we came back up, and then we went down. And then we came back up, and then we went down. And I kept saying to God, I sure wish Bob would learn this lesson so we don't have to go through this financial problem again. I think it took the third time before God said, maybe we're going through it for you. Because if you've ever been there, you think, well, I don't have a problem with money. I've never had a problem with money. Well, it's because you have it. When I didn't have it, things changed. So God works on us, and he has consistently had to work on my heart in those couple of areas, plus lots of other things that come up because there are a lot of other issues that need to be dealt with. But continually needs to teach me. And one of those is submission. We've talked a little bit about that, and I get to teach you that. I'll be back in time to teach you submission because of my personality. So there are lots of things that we have to go through in trials. We're distressed by various trials. In this you greatly rejoice. You greatly rejoice in your salvation, even though now what? Even though now what? For a little while. What does that tell you, Jenny? It's just for a little while. It's not going to go on forever. There's another verse, 1 Peter 5:10, that we'll discuss about trials, and it says, for a little while. That particular phrase has been very important to Jenny this year. For a little while. So rest in that. Even though you're going through trials, no matter what it is, it's only for a little while, folks. Now, that little while may be days or hours or years, but it's not forever. And Jesus will take care of it. He will. The problem may not change, but he'll change your attitude. He'll change your heart. And that's the most important thing. Hang on to that, though. Hang on to your salvation in Jesus Christ, because you greatly rejoice in that, and that's going to carry you through these, through the proof of your salvation. In this you greatly rejoice, now for a little while, if necessary. What does if necessary mean? Maybe you've already arrived. Maybe God doesn't need to work on you because you've been learning without him having to bring these trials or allow these trials into your life. I'm a little more stubborn. I usually learn by other people's mistakes, but sometimes I have to go through it and go through it and go through it in order to find out what God wants me to learn, if necessary. So that means that maybe God will bypass a trial in our lives because we will learn from his word how he wants us to live, and we'll change without going through a trial. God's timing and our timing aren't the same. So his little while and our little while are a little different. But so, you know, just a year and a half, is that about how long it was? Yeah, about a year and a half in that particular issue in her life. So, you know, that's a long time in the scheme of life. But I waited 17 years for my husband to come to know the Lord, so a year and a half is a piece of cake. You know, it's all relative. It's a little while, but the point is God's in charge of the timing, if you will let him. What that tells me, too, is she says it gives her hope, and it also gives you the idea that this trial will be over at some point. Absolutely. She said she believes the trials bring us close to the Lord. So we don't really grow on the mountaintops. Technically, that's where we're just excited and we're on fire for Jesus. But we grow in the valleys. And the deeper the valleys, the more we grow. And I mean, there's one of my favorite verses, again, is Hebrews chapter 12. It says, let me get it. We also have some in Peter that we're going to discuss. But this says in Hebrews 12:11, all discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful but sorrowful. Yet to those who've been trained by it, afterwards it yields a peaceful fruit of righteousness. That's Hebrews 12:11. After you've been trained by it. It's not fun at the time, but once you've gone through it, and once you've seen what God's doing and how he's changed you and made you more like him, afterwards it yields a peaceful fruit of righteousness. And none of us like to go through trials, but if we know that God will walk us through it, and afterwards he will have perfected us so that we are closer to him, that's a hope that we need to get us through that. She talked about Paul, who had a thorn in the flesh, and he asked three times that God take it away, and God didn't. So God has a reason for doing what he's doing. She brings a very good point out. We don't know how God's going to use this trial in our lives. But she said that in her life, she was able to use it to help others. And Tom, my friend, spent all of his time in the rescue ministry and the jail ministry. Because what he was rescued from, he wanted to help those people who were in that. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 says, "The God of all comfort, who comforts you with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God, he will use that comfort so we can use it to comfort others." That's not a direct quote, but that's close enough. 2 Corinthians 1, 3, God comforts us so that we can comfort others. God helps us through our trials so that we can help somebody else. If you ladies have not memorized James 1, 2 through 4, you haven't been through enough trials. Most of the trial verses in Scripture I know by heart because I was able to use them when I needed God's help. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials. I will just stop there. Consider it all joy. Active, present tense, verb. Continuously consider it all joy. Most of us groan and complain and whine and do everything we can to stop it instead of considering all joy. Yeah, she said, she's right. She said our trials go away in the blink of an eye. So we need to use it for what God's going to do in our lives. Now, I also have to remind you too, and I never remember what they are, so I'm looking them up to see if I can find them. Oh, yes, the five stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, blame, and acceptance. Five stages of grief: denial, anger, bargaining, blame, and acceptance. So when we go through trials, sometimes we go through these emotions. First we deny, then we're mad, we're angry, then we bargain with God, then we blame others or God or whomever, and then finally we accept it. So I tell you that just to say that even though you're going through a trial and you're considering it all joy, it doesn't mean you're not going to go through these emotional points of grief or frustration or pain. Of course you will. You're human. But in the midst of all that, you need to trust in God. We need to trust in God. We need to look to our salvation. The proof of our faith, it says here, talking about in you've been distressed by various trials, that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Gold melts at 1947 degrees Fahrenheit. Gold is smelted in order to get the imperfections off between 840 and 1380 degrees Fahrenheit. That's pretty hot. If you and I were to go through those ovens, we'd die instantly. When God wants to prove our faith, it's going to get hot. It's going to get painful. After all, if you look at the smelting process, if you understand what it takes, the first thing that they have to do when they smelt something is they take a rock and they break it. And because inside the rock, you've got ore and zinc and copper and all kinds of minerals, but you also might have gold and silver. Well, they don't know that unless they break open a rock. So the first thing is you have to break it. Ouch. We get broken on whatever it is we're going through. Then they put it in a crucible. That means some big instrument that will withstand those almost 2,000 degrees of heat. They have to put it in that. When they do that, then the dross, as they put it in this heat and they turn on the heat, the dross starts coming to the top. Primarily in silver, gold's a little different, but still, there's the methods of getting imperfections out of gold now are a little bit more sophisticated. But back in the time of the Bible, they would turn up the heat very slowly, and gradually this dross would come to the top. They would scoop off the dross, then they would turn up the heat a little bit more, and they'd scoop off more of the dross. You know how many times they did that? Seven times. Let's see. Psalm 12:6 says, "The word of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace on earth, refined seven times." Silver is refined seven times. God's talking about refining us seven times. Psalm 12:6 is where that was from. So the dross is taken off each time, and then the heat's brought up a little bit more. So just, you know, you get in a trial, and you're seeing a little bit of light at the end of the tunnel, and you think, okay, it's there. Whoops, nope, heat's gone up a little bit more. We're going further down. Oops, nope, heat's gone up a little bit more. How many times did you think you were finished with something, and it just never ended? Well, that's the heat getting turned up more and more. If you turn it up too fast, it'll destroy the silver. So you got to do it little by little. If it was turned up on us too fast, we'd be devastated. We wouldn't be able to survive it. But God does it little by little until finally, after the seventh time, all the dross has been taken off and the refiner can look in that silver and see his reflection. And God wants to be able to look at the dross that's taken out of our lives so he can look at the pure silver, the pure gold, and see his reflection in our lives. The dross doesn't get taken out in the silver or gold unless it's heated by fire. The dross, I'm sorry, but we're selfish people. If I know I need to learn something, sometimes I'll learn it, but most of the time it comes with pain because I don't want to give up myself or my selfish desires in order to learn it. I love that. As the gold or the silver is melted, it becomes moldable so that we can be molded more like him. And you know that gold is more dense than silver, so it's more easily molded. That's why you used to have in the olden days, it's not so much now, but in the olden days, gold was, you see ancient intricate earrings and bracelets that they had at the time of Egypt and so forth, because gold was easily, more easily molded than silver. What example does God use here? Gold. So we could be more easily molded than silver. So God is molding us, it says, more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and honor and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, future. He's building us up during these days so that we can be continuously serving him, walking with him until we be with him. Well, she did say one thing that said several things. Trials, we think, what good are they? They're not only to refine us, but others. When people say, well, I can't have a handicapped child because I don't have time to take care of it. I don't have the money to take care of it. But what does that child mean to other people? I mean, we know, have a friend who has a Down's handicapped daughter, and I'm telling you, she's a joy to everybody who knows her. And so who are we to play God? When God allows difficult things in our lives, we need to remember, this is the proof of our faith. These trials. God's using them. Now, trials come for lots of reasons. They can come because we live in a sinful world and there's death and there's sin and there's all kinds of bad things that happen. So they could come just because people are bad. Trials can come because God allows them in our lives to grow our faith. Or in Deuteronomy 8:2, to test us, to see what's in our hearts. God needs to do that sometimes too. He wants to know where our heart is. I mean, it took me 3 financial upheavals to realize that I was the problem. I shouldn't say I was, but at least I had an issue that I didn't know I had in my life. I was kept thinking that Bob needed to learn his lesson when in fact God needed to teach me something too. So we need to remember that. Another reason for trials is that Satan wants us to fall and fail in everything we do. So he might do something. But don't blame him. I told you last week I had someone who fell, got back into drugs, and that person blamed Satan. Well, ultimately, yes, it's Satan, but take personal responsibility and don't focus on Satan, because God will cause all things to work together for good, even if Satan's trying to bring them into your life. Don't worry about figuring out the why. Just remember the who, and it's Jesus Christ. So now we have that the proof of our faith will bring about trials. It goes on to tell us in verse 8, and though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexplicable and full of glory. Who is the him? Jesus. That's who we've been talking about. And though you have not seen him, that's still in the tense, that's still yet future. You haven't seen him. You'll see him in the future. But you love him. That's present tense, agape love, unconditional love that you and I have for the God that we haven't seen. That's hope. Hebrews 11:1, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. We haven't seen Jesus, but we hope for Jesus and what he's giving us. So we haven't seen him, that's future, but we love him, that's present. And though you don't see him now, that's present, you do what? You believe in him now. That's your present sanctification. You continue on going, believing in Jesus. You don't give up because you're going through trials. You continue living your salvation, believing in him. And then it says, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory. So what's our response of faith? Rejoicing. And therefore, if we're looking at the proof of faith being trials, then our response to faith needs to be rejoicing during trials. That's that James 1:2, consider it all joy when you encounter various trials. Do you do it because it's natural? No, you do it because, verse 8, what does it say in verse 8? You love him, you're focusing on Jesus. Don't focus on the trial, folks. If you do, it'll get you down. Because in our eyes, there's no way out of a lot of trials. I remember standing in my kitchen window when my youngest was, this is 1985, standing in my kitchen window crying because I wouldn't have enough money to send my kids to college. Now, this is me, future thinking. I couldn't afford to buy detergent to wash their clothes at that time. And I'm not thinking about that. I'm way in the future. I won't be able to pay for them to go to college. And that's when I learned I just had to trust God. And by the time they got to college, we were able to pay for our kids to go to college. Because I didn't worry about the problem. I sought the King, the solver of all problems. And if we hadn't had enough to send them to college, they wouldn't have gone to college. But we did. The point being is don't focus on the problems. Focusing on them will get you down. There was no way back then that we would have enough money to send them to college. But instead of saying, my tendency is, well, I've got to figure out how we're going to do this then over the next 15 years. I couldn't figure it out. So I just had to pray. I just had to be who God wanted me to be and learn what he wanted me to learn. That's what he wants us to do in the midst of trials. His ways are not our ways. He does exceeding abundantly beyond all that we could ask or think or even imagine. Verse 9, it goes on to say that now that we have trials that are the proof of our faith and the response is rejoicing in who Jesus is, verse 9, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the what?
Salvation
of your souls. So we have the outcome, the salvation of our souls. Now, do you think that this is talking about our born again past salvation? Well, the outcome of our faith, I mean, our faith is relating to salvation, past, present, and future. In this context, we seem to be the present salvation, but salvation of our souls happens past, and it goes on in present, and it will continue on in the future. But the outcome of our faith, the outcome of your faith, of your walking through these trials with an attitude of seeking, rejoicing in the Lord, I'm going to put here, rejoicing in him, is the salvation of your soul. If you think of that on a present tense salvation, it's what's going to keep you going in the midst of your trial, knowing who Jesus is and what you have in him, having that hope in the future, the salvation of your souls. Rejoicing in the Lord. If you recall, we just finished Philippians in the spring. And the main theme of the book of Philippians from Philippians 4:4 was, rejoice in the Lord always. And Paul was in prison when he wrote that. Rejoice in the Lord always. That's the kind of attitude that we're supposed to follow. Verse 10. As to this salvation, we're talking about the proof of salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that would come to you made careful search and inquiry, seeking to know what person or time the Spirit of Christ within them was indicating as he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow. What does that mean? First of all, who's it talking about? The prophets of old, the Old Testament prophets. And they prophesied of what? grace, okay? True grace is salvation. Salvation comes through Jesus Christ. So they prophesied of this grace that would come to you. And they made careful search and inquiry. They wanted to know when the time was going to be that this salvation was going to come. It was indicated to them as they predicted the what of Christ? Sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow. So when we consider the prophecies of faith, what were the prophecies of the Old Testament prophets by? What did they prophesy? The sufferings of Christ and the grace to follow. Glories to follow. Glories to follow. That's what they prophesied. Did they prophesy in this passage? Is it talking about Christ and his glory, how he's going to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and how he's going to reign forever? No, it prophesied his sufferings. Why? Why would they focus on the sufferings? Because that's what you and I are going to go through. If you and I want to have the glory of our salvation, if we want to understand our salvation, we are going to go through the sufferings like Christ did. And then after we go through those sufferings, we're going to be able to glory in them. Do you? Is that your attitude? Verse 12 ends up by saying, it was revealed to them that they were not serving themselves, but you in these things, which now have been announced to you through those who preach the gospel to you by the Spirit, by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. Well, there's a lot there, but we're just going to tell you what it means here. It was revealed to these prophets that they weren't going to have the salvation. They were looking for the salvation that was going to, I didn't say that right. They were looking for the salvation that was to come. That faith in the coming Messiah would save them, but they weren't going to realize the Messiah. We were going to realize the Messiah through Jesus Christ. They were saved on their faith of the coming Messiah. We're saved on our faith of the Messiah who has come. That's what that means. The gospel was preached to us by the Spirit sent from heaven. And when it says things into which angels long to look, well, what that means is angels stoop sideways. It's kind of like they're peeking around the corner because they want to look and they want to see, but angels don't participate in salvation. That's a whole different ballgame. They're different creatures. So don't get confused with that there. We have laid out for us in these first 12 chapters of 1 Peter, the doctrine of salvation, which is the Trinity drawing us to God himself and bringing us unto obedience. We have then an understanding that salvation isn't just a one-time experience. From the moment you receive Jesus Christ until you get to eternity and then beyond, that's your salvation. It's ongoing. Don't let that wonderful aspect of salvation be lost in a past experience. Instead, enjoy your continuous ongoing salvation. Remember, Paul said, I press on towards the goal of the prize of the upward calling in Christ Jesus. You press on, continuous ongoing, living out your salvation day by day. Doesn't mean you're saved again day by day. It means you're living it out day by day. And that's going to mean trials. God knows what's in your heart. He doesn't need to see it, but we do. I needed to see what was going on in my heart. And God allowed trials to change that. Those trials then, God has taught me. It hasn't been easy, but he has taught me to rejoice in trials, knowing that he's in control and he has a purpose and plan. And the outcome eventually is the growth, the holiness, the deliverance for my soul into how I'm living my life here versus how God wants me to live it. And I can look to Christ as an example. Because he suffered. The prophecies of his suffering are my example to bring me through it. We're going to talk a lot more about suffering, aren't you glad? In chapter 4, when we talk about it there. But we need to understand it, because if you want to be more like Christ, it's not going to happen just because you want it. You're going to have to learn about it. Ladies, when trials come your way, don't look at them as a bad thing. You may not like them. They may not be comfortable. But just turn to the Lord and turn it over to Him and say, God, help me through this. Guide me through this, but more importantly, let me be more like You. Take off that dross so that You can see Yourself in my life. Change your attitude about how you look at these trials. They're really not a negative. They're a positive. Let's pray. Father, You have shown us unequivocally what salvation is. It is Your sovereign hand that has reached out and chosen us. We have to obey, we have to believe, but it is Your workings through the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And when You chose us, You gave us an eternal salvation, a moment of time that we were saved from our sins. And then this life that we live today to be perfected, sanctified in how we walk with You and serve You and grow with You and be prepared then for our eternity with You. So that when we see You, we will have confidence when we look on You. Instead of shying away in shame because we have not walked with You. Father, would You help us work on our salvation day by day? Would You help us see trials as an opportunity for growth, as an opportunity to draw closer to You instead of for the pain that they cause? Let us focus on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, rather than on ourselves, on this world, or on the trials. Because when we do, we will rejoice with exceedingly great joy when we have our eyes on You. That's the heart and the attitude You want us to have as Your followers. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today on Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank. Living Word Ministries is a listener-supported program. To contact Debbie Blank, you may do so at livingwordministry.org. That's www.livingwordministry.org. Please tune in each week at the same time for Living Word Ministries with Debbie Blank.